Good morning, church. Pastor Joe McGarry here from Prince of Peace Lutheran Church in Kensington, Connecticut. Today we continue our series called Faithfulness on how to be a faithful Christian in 2021 and beyond. So today we are talking about calling and our own call stories and how we are called. What does that look like in terms of our life of faith? So we will be reading from Genesis chapter 12 and the call story of Abraham. The one announcement I have before we begin our service is that we are participating in Walk the Walk 2021 for Camp Calumet. This is a fundraiser for the Lutheran camp here in New England to help get kids to camp by forming scholarships. And so we are participating in that. We have Team Prince of Peace in Kensington, Connecticut. So you can sign up in two ways. You can go to the Camp Calumet website and you can find your way to Walk the Walk 2021, fill out the form and sign up and make sure you put your team as Prince of Peace Lutheran Church in Kensington, Connecticut. Or you can go to our form and we can sign up for you on your behalf. So if you go to popkensington.org/walkthewalk, you can fill out our form. Our office administrator will sign you up and send you an email with all the details that you need to know. You can count all of your steps this summer if you are using a smart wearable band like an Apple Watch or a Fitbit or any other wearable device. You can get a little pedometer that you can wear this summer. If you go out running, you can count your running miles. If you go out biking or canoeing, you can count those miles as well. So I hope you join us. You don't have to be a member of Prince of Peace Lutheran Church to join our team. Just by watching this service and getting to know us through YouTube or Facebook, you can join our team. If you have friends that want to join, if you have a walking club, we would love to have them be a part of our team as well. Just share the information with them. Thank you again for joining us and enjoy the service. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the God of manna, the God of miracles, the God of mercy. Amen. Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, let us confess our sin. God, our provider, help us. It is hard to believe there is enough to share. We question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life and feed us for the life in the world. Amen. Beloved people of God, in Jesus, the manna from heaven, you are fed and nourished. By Jesus, the worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus, the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy and you are forgiven into abundant life. Amen. A reading from Genesis chapter 12. Now the Lord said to Abram, "Go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and the ones who curse you, I will curse. And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed." So Abraham went as the Lord told him, and Lot went with him. Abraham was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. Abraham took his wife Sarah and his brother's son Lot and all the possessions that they gathered and the persons whom they had acquired in Haran, and they set forth to the land of Canaan. So when they had come to the land of Canaan, Abraham passed through the land to the place of Shechem, to the oak of Morah. At that time, the Canaanites were in the land. Then the Lord appeared to Abraham and said, "To you and your offspring I will give you this land." So he built there an altar to the Lord who had appeared to him. From there, he moved on to the hill country east of Bethel and pitched his tent. With Bethel on the west and Ai on the east, there he built an altar to the Lord and invoked the name of the Lord. And Abraham journeyed on by stages towards Negev. Now, there was a famine in the land, so Abraham went down to Egypt to reside there as an alien, for the famine was severe in the land. When he was about to enter Egypt, he said to his wife Sarah, "Now I know that you are a woman who is beautiful in appearance, and when the Egyptians see you, they will say, 'This is his wife.' And then they will kill me, but they will let you live. Say that you are my sister, so that it may go well with me because of you, and that my life may be spared on your account." When Abraham entered Egypt, the Egyptians saw that he had a beautiful woman who was next to him. When the officials of Pharaoh saw her, they praised her to Pharaoh, and the woman was taken into Pharaoh's house. And for her sake, he dealt well with Abraham, and he had sheep and oxen, male donkeys, male and female slaves, female donkeys and camels. But the Lord afflicted Pharaoh and his house with great plagues because of Sarah, Abraham's wife. So Pharaoh called Abraham and said, "What is this that you have done to me? Why did you not tell me that she was your wife? Why did you say that she is my sister, so that I took her as my wife? Now then, here is your wife. Take her and be gone." And Pharaoh gave his men orders concerning him, and they set on him his way with his wife Sarah and all that he had. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. Last week, we started our series on faithfulness. We talked about how we are blessed and we can see that blessing in our lives starting in the creation. And the importance of sharing that blessing through the words of the Beatitudes. Today, we are looking at calling. Now, admittedly, I talk a lot about God calling us and how we should discern our calling. And one of the questions that I receive after I talk about calling is, how do I know that I am being called by God? What does it look like? What does it feel like? Now, that is a complicated question to answer because callings look very differently from one person to another. The Bible is filled with call stories. People that are being called by God. And no two call stories are ever the same. Today, we take a look at Abraham's call story in Genesis chapter 12. And the chapters that follow this story talk about the life and the work of Abraham and Sarah and their descendants. God called Abraham and Sarah and their family to leave their home, a home that they loved, and go to a new country that God would eventually show them. God called Abraham to go to a place where he was unfamiliar with the surroundings, to do things that Abraham was not prepared to do. And God made promises to Abraham that seemed simply impossible. God promised to make Abraham's family into a great nation. In you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed, God said. And Abraham and Sarah did not think that this was possible because for so many years they were unable to conceive a child. But God said to Abraham, I will bless you. And this was a promise that Abraham held on to because he knew that he didn't do anything to deserve it. This promise of blessing wasn't because he was a perfect person. Instead, it was a gift of love and grace. Abraham did not do anything to deserve God's blessings and promises. Abraham was chosen by God to receive God's blessings, chosen to give this pure gift to Abraham, this gift that has been passed along from generation to generation, this gift that has been given to us because we too are children of Abraham. So whenever I think about Abraham's call story, I am inspired because I know that we too have been called by God. We too have been given this promise of grace and love from God. We too are blessed in our callings. So when I go back to the question, how do I know that I have been called from God? What does it look like? What does it feel like? Well, we receive calls in various ways. One way could be an audible spoken call by God, where someone actually hears God's voice. And I have heard of people receiving a call this way, but I have never experienced a call in that way before. Another is having people in our life. Like when someone goes up to you and says, oh, wouldn't you be really good at this? And someone else says, oh, I've been thinking about you lately. You should try this. Someone else says it, and eventually start putting the pieces together and say, maybe God is calling me to do something. Maybe God has placed these people in my life to help me think about my calling. And then you start to pray and ask God to show you the right way to go. Now, the way that I have felt God's calling to me a number of times in my life, and the most common way that I hear other people talk about God's calling in their life is through the feelings that we get. Now, for example, Prince of Peace is the third congregation where I have been pastor. And each time that I have left a congregation, I've had this feeling that God was calling me to look for new opportunities. And it wasn't just a one-time feeling, but it was something that came to me again and again and again. Then I take time to think and pray, what is God calling me to do next? How is God calling me to move forward? Am I being called to leave this community and join another one? And I don't do this alone. I talk with my family about my calling and my discernment. I talk with my peers. I talk with a spiritual director, a pastor, or a coach. Along with the calling from God, there are promises that are made. Once someone is called by God, there is this revelation of promises. For Abraham, there were three promises. First, God said to Abraham, I will be with you and I will bless you so that you will be a blessing to others. No matter where you go, no matter what you do on your journey of life, I will be with you. I will bless you and my presence will be with you so that you can be a blessing to the world. Friends, this is the same promise that God makes to us as well. When you feel that God is putting you out there to do something, to say something that may be uncomfortable or unfamiliar, when God is calling you, God's promise to you is that God will be with you at your side in this journey called life. The second promise is that God made to Abraham was that his descendants would be numerous. There would be millions and millions of descendants, like the sands of the sea or the stars in the sky. And Abraham fully trusted that God would be faithful to him, that God's promises would give him descendants, and God fulfilled that promise. We are promised this ourselves, and our descendants, our legacy, is the church. Because when we look around, things don't look well in our churches, not just our church, but churches in general. Things don't look like church is ever going to grow again. But we are connected to one another, and God's promise is that the church is going to continue. We don't know how, we don't know what that looks like or what that feels like, but long term, one way or another, the church is going to continue. And the third promise that God promised Abraham is the promised land. That Abraham and his descendants would have a land to grow their crops, a land flowing with milk and honey, a land rich in abundance. We are also given that promise. Now, one thing I continue to ask is, what does the promised land look like for us? So this promise, this calling, this covenant that God makes with Abraham was to bless not only Abraham's family, but to bless us as well, because we too are recipients of the blessings that Abraham has received. God works through all of us to connect us to each other, connect us to the world, and to show the world the power of God's love. God called Abraham to leave his home and everything that was familiar to him. So when God said, leave your country, your people, your father's household, and go to the land that I will show you, Abraham was nervous. He didn't know what that would look like, what that would feel like. But Abraham listened. So Abraham gathered his family and all his possessions and left and set out for the land of Canaan. But this story is so much more than just moving from one place to another, because Abraham left all that was familiar. Abraham left all that was comfortable to him. He left his family and his friends, his rhythm of life. The only thing that he would retain from his home were the memories. The story is a journey from being comfortable going to a future that was uncomfortable. Abraham journeyed from what he had to what he did not have. He journeyed from the known into the unknown. He journeyed from everything that was familiar to all things that were strange. Later on in the book of Hebrews, the author recognized this when he said, by faith, Abraham, when called to go to a place that he would later receive as his home, obeyed and went. Even though he did not know where he was going, by faith, he made his home in the promised land like a stranger in a foreign country. Hebrews chapter 11. We too are called to go to a place that might not be familiar to us. We too are called to go into things that might be unfamiliar or uncomfortable. We too experience things that seem strange or uncertain. Sometimes it could be leaving our home and going to a new land like Abraham. Other times we are called to leave our traditions, to leave what we know, what we have always done, and be called to leave the familiar and do something new. Sometimes we are called to leave our relationships or to leave our jobs. There are many things that God calls us to do. And when we listen to that call, when we accept that call, God promises to be with us. God promises to never leave us. God promises that what we do will have a legacy that will outlive us all. So I invite you to not only think about what God is calling you to do in a personal way, but what is God calling our church to do? Because we are entering in a world where things are going to be different for our church. Certain things feel like we are getting back to the way things have always been. But the reality is we live in a different world. And things continue to change. So we need to discern together what God is calling us to do. So the question I will leave you with today is, what is God calling you to do next? What is God calling you to do next? This is an important question that shapes not only your future, but also the future of our church. And I would love to hear what God is calling you to do next. So feel free to leave a comment below in this video, or feel free to email me at pastor@popkensington.org and let me know, what is God calling you to do next? Amen.
I have heard you. clay. I will tend the poor and lame. I will set a feast for them. My hand will save. Finest bread I will provide till their hearts be satisfied. I will give my life to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night.
Let us come before the triune God in prayer. God of hope, the ministry of your church extends across borders, from nearby neighbors to far and distant countries. Accompany all those who labor eagerly in service of the gospel, that through your good news all might experience transformation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty God, we give you thanks for the air we breathe, the water we drink, the land that provides our food. Guard all species of plants and animals from harsh changes in climate, and empower us to protect all that you have made. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Righteous God, we pray for the nations and their leaders. Give them a spirit of compassion and steer them towards a fair distribution of resources, that none among us would have too much or too little. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of healing, your touch has the power to make us whole. We pray for those suffering from physical or mental illness. Embrace those who are sick. Surround them with your unwavering presence. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for this assembly, both those who are gathered here in person and those who are online. Revive our spirits, renew our relationships, and rekindle our faith, that we might experience resurrection in this community. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give thanks for the faithful ancestors in every age whose lives have pointed us towards you. Envelop them in your love, that we may be reunited with one another in the last days. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We lift our prayers to you, O God, trusting in your abiding grace. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you all. I invite you to share the peace with one another. Let us confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us and our salvation. He came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit,
the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The blessing of God, who provides for us, feeds us, and journeys with us, be upon you, now and forever. Amen.
Go, make disciples, baptizing them, teaching them. Go, make disciples. Salt of the earth, go. Be a light for the world, go. Be a city on a hill so all can see that you're serving me. Go, make disciples, baptizing them, teaching them. Go, make disciples. Salt of the earth, go. Be the light for the world, go. Be a city on a hill so all can see that you're serving me. Go, make disciples.
Go in peace. You are the body of Christ. Thanks be to God. Finest bread I will provide, till their hearts be satisfied. I will give my life to them, whom shall I send? Here I am.